You know the words.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise.
Sing it, church.
Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God in three persons, blessed Trinity.
We approach the throne of the Father by the power of the Spirit through the blood of the Son. And we say, Trinity, we have come to bask in your holiness and to listen, not to a bunch of guys who are going to talk about what they think or have experienced, but hopefully, Lord, that we will be surrendered enough that the Spirit deposited in us will resonate with the Spirit from on high, and we will know the truth. And the truth will set us free. Come now. Superintend all things here and now. May you increase, Jesus. May we decrease. Amen. I want to talk about persecution. Just a lovely thing to talk about. Luckily, I'm a suburban pastor in a pretty wealthy church, and I don't have no squat about persecution. But the Lord is funny in his ways, and sometimes he wakes us up to things that we might not normally awaken to. And one of those has been persecution. And through my friendship with Andrew and Norine Brunson, and through many other ways, God has shaken me and warned me. And I want to just talk about for a second warning. We all need warnings. We need to know when things are wrong and when we shouldn't do it. When we go out to eat for dinner, my wife often asks the server, is there garlic in this? Because she has a garlic allergy. She just wants to be warned so she can pick the right thing. And most of the time, the warnings that we get are not super significant. But I took this picture in Hawaii one day, and I found it reasonably significant that I didn't really want to go snorkeling that day at that beach. And so sometimes the warnings the Lord gives us are far more significant. And I think the Lord wants especially the shepherds of the church, the elders of the church, to pay attention to the signs of the times. I think the average Joe and Sally in our pew might not want to pay attention. I think they'd rather go about their life and plan everything easily. And I'm an optimist. I mean, I not only believe that the glass is half full, but I believe that the pitcher is under the fountain. And we'll always have stuff. That's kind of my normal nature, is to be very positive and optimistic. And I have a deep faith in the Lord that everything works out. So I'm really an optimist. And so to talk about persecution or to look at the signs of the time and come up with anything less than an absolutely optimistic answer runs against the grain of who I am. And yet, Jesus replied, when evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. Jesus is specifically critical of the religious leaders of his day. Not the average people, but the leaders who really are not paying attention, who have their own agendas and their own ideas and their own thoughts and their own motion. Jesus is particularly frustrated with the religious pastors of his day, for they aren't really taking care of the flock. They know whether it's going to rain or not rain. They can plan their outings or their picnics just fine, but they don't really see the signs of the times. And I don't want that to be true for us. And so it leads me to something else that Jesus specifically says to his disciples. If the world hates you, keep in mind it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world. But I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Paul is almost killed on his missionary journey to Ephesus, and on his third trip, he's afraid to even go back to the city, so he stops at a little port town a few miles away, and he calls the Ephesian rulers and elders, the ruling elders and the teaching elders, those pastors of the church, to come to this little place called Miletus, and they have this sob fest because he's leaving. He can't even go to the city because he's afraid they'll kill him, because the persecution is so great. And these are the words that he leaves them with. Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Well, that's great, Brad. Jesus really wanted people to be ready, but that was a long time ago in a world far, far away. But I will tell you that in one of Paul's last letters to his paduan, protege, Timothy, there is a hard truth that I think we need to wrestle with. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Did you hear that? Are you wrestling with the truth of the Word of God for a second? Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. I think the Lord is really clear of what he says to his church, and at different times he says it in different ways. We've been living through one of the most gracious seasons for maybe 50 years as American Western Christians, where the cultural Christianity has kind of safeguarded the church in a lot of ways. But I got to tell you, that's all blown away. There is no such thing anymore. And so now the real bones of what we believe and who we are exposed to a culture that doesn't necessarily think like we do or act like we do or resonate with what we resonate. And so the warnings that didn't seem all that relevant in the days of Andy of Mayberry are way more relevant today. So on this journey, Andrew and Norine Brunson had a warning experience. That's a pretty simple thing to call about 2 years and 5 days in a prison cell, a warning experience. But I believe it was at least in part that. In 2016, October, Andrew, who was pastoring a little church in Turkey, was arrested for his faith, accused of treason, badgered with all sorts of things that weren't true about all the insurrection he was supporting, and he was thrown into prison, and his wife Norine was arrested too, but then later released. And this 2-year period, I think, became the crucible of one of God's warnings to us. And I'll explain more about that after Andrew speaks, why I think this warning is today and this warning is for us, my brothers and sisters. But Andrew experienced it. He lived it. He practiced it. And out of that experience came this sense of, here's some truths that would really help Christians if they just knew these things. I don't want everybody to have to go to jail for 2 years or be afraid that you're going to get 2 life sentences. Andrew came up through the birthing of the Holy Spirit, I think, in him with some things that help us to be prepared. And so a video series was created called Prepare to Stand. 8 videos, each 15 or 20 minutes long, where Andrew just talks about, here's a point about persecution. Here's some of the dangers. Here's some of the wrong ways to react. Here's some of the things that will get you through. And by God's touch and grace, some really significant Christian organizations got behind it, and they said, we want to publish these. We want them to be out there. So Andrew made, with the help of Samaritan Purse, 8 videos, and then I had the privilege of writing a study guide with all the facts and the quotes and the background scriptures so that you could teach it or preach it or have a Bible study where let's watch the video and then let's talk about it. With all of the data there, we tried to put it together, and they're now up for free. Doesn't cost you anything. Doesn't cost anybody anything. You can go to the epc.org site, Prepare to Stand, and you can download all the videos and the study guide. You can go to the Family Research Council site and download it all. It's all right there. There are other places too, but my point is, the goal is to give you an opportunity, maybe to go back to your session and say, as the leader, should we at least not spend 15 minutes at our next several session meetings and learn so that we're ready to guide if things do get hard? If you're a Bible scholar, you know that the book of Revelation ends gloriously, but it goes through a whole bunch of manure on its way there for the believers of Christ. It is a difficult time. So I can promise you, a wave is coming. I don't know when. I'm not going to predict who's going to be president or in charge when that happens, but I am convinced to the very bottom of my soul that a wave of persecution is coming. And when we shared this with the national leadership team, they said, we got to tell the people in the EPC. And so I'd like you to welcome Dr. Andrew Brunson to come up and share.
Can I take your computer down? I'll just put it here.
Perfect.
All right. I was standing in my home in Northern Virginia, the DC suburbs, yesterday morning, thinking that a day later, which is today, that I would be with you, pastors and leaders of the EPC. And what I felt was just this wave of gratefulness. A wave of gratefulness that I have the opportunity to speak to you, a group of pastors, because you're pastors, because you're leaders at a very critical time. And I think of the great shepherd has appointed you his under shepherds to protect and nurture and care for his people. And this is a difficult assignment. In the year or so after I was released from prison, the Lord impressed on me that he had trusted me with a difficult assignment. And, you know, that really touched my heart when he showed that to me, that he had trusted me with a difficult assignment. Because to be trusted by God with a difficult assignment is actually a privilege. And it didn't feel that way to me while I was in prison. I did not feel privileged, but it was an honor. I came to see that. And he has trusted you with a difficult assignment, an assignment that's difficult in normal times, but that I think is going to become much more so in the days ahead. So I'm not a pastor now. I don't have to deal with the various and competing streams in the church as many of you do, and I know that many pastors are worn out by the pressures that have just become more intense in the last couple of years. So I want you to know that as I speak today, I really do come with an attitude of humility, and I want to honor all of you who do have this difficult assignment of shepherding and pastoring during this time. And I want to emphasize one thing in this session, and that's that the sheep are in danger. The sheep are in danger, and you have the assignment of shepherding them. So I believe there's this dark wave of hostility, the wave that Brad has mentioned. I think this wave of hostility is going to crash onto the church. And since returning to the U.S. for the first time in my life, my wife and I both grew up as missionary kids. We spent 25 years in Turkey. I did not really think about the States except as the place of safety we could go back to. But since coming back here, for the first time in my life, I have a burden for this country and a real sense of urgency that I believe God birthed in my heart for this place. And it's urgent. I have this sense of urgency because of the timing. I think there's a timing to this wave. It's coming. And I think what makes it a matter of urgency is that most of us are not ready for it. So in broad strokes, I want to draw a picture of where I think we are at present and of what we can expect in the future. And my goal really is to, I want to make a case that there's a wave coming, because actually I think that many people don't really see it. Sometimes when I speak in churches or different places, the older crowd kind of nods their head. They get it, and the younger ones say, I don't know what he's talking about. And so there can be a sense of maybe denial or else saying, carry on, everything's going to be okay, it's all going to work out well, but I don't think this is true. And there can be a confidence sometimes in a political rescue. And the political is important, but I think it is not sufficient. I think our culture, the commanding heights of our culture, are going to persecute. They have so turned against faithful followers of Jesus that the cultural changes that have taken place in the U.S. in the last generations are so fundamental that they're not going to be undone by government policy. So there is not a political rescue coming, not in the next and the one after and the midterms after that. I don't think that's going to rescue us. And so I want to make a case that there is a wave coming and that we need to prepare, because if we are aware, if we see the signs of the times, if we discern the times, then we can begin to take action to prepare for them. So I want to draw in broad strokes today, and I mentioned the commanding heights of our culture. I think that every institution in our society, every institution that I'm aware of, is in the hands of people who are increasingly hostile to faithful followers of Jesus. I can't think of a single major institution, the sources of power, of messaging, that have the biggest platforms, that shape public opinion. Arts, media, entertainment, professional sports, big tech, big business, most of the academic world. Well, I guess now we can say K through 12 plus universities. Most of government bureaucracy. Increasingly the higher ranks in the military, much of the legal establishment, increasingly hostile to faithful followers of Jesus. So I think we already see that, and I think of two main wedge issues that I think will drive persecution. The first is the exclusivity of Jesus in salvation, because we are claiming to have truth, and that's a problem nowadays, but saying Jesus is the only way to God. And secondly, that he demands obedience from his followers. He demands obedience in a number of areas that are very hotly contested in our culture: life, family, sexual morality, gender identity, biblical justice. I'm sure you can think of others. But there are areas where there's going to be a very stark difference with what our culture is supporting and celebrating and what a faithful follower of Jesus has to do as a matter of obedience. Not necessarily preference, but as a matter of being a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. So I think we will see violence over this Roe decision. If it's overturned, we will see violence. But you probably won't get fired from your job if you say you're pro-life. You can easily get fired or canceled for not celebrating LGBT, for not using the right pronouns. Wherever religious freedom clashes with LGBT, we're losing in this culture. So I think things have changed. I want to argue that things have changed. There's a writer named Aaron Wren, you may have heard of him. He talks about this change that's come into our culture over the last generations. And that pre-1994, there was positive world, is what he calls it. And Christianity was generally viewed positively by society. Christian morality was normative. It doesn't mean everyone was living according to Christian standards, but Christian standards, the standards of the Bible, were held in high regard. Now, I know that people have always suffered persecution. Anytime that you truly are faithful followers of Jesus, people may ridicule and mock you and do things like that. But generally, across the country, Christianity was not viewed negatively. To be seen as a religious person, one who exemplifies traditional Christian norms, was a social positive. I'm just going to read what he says about it. Christianity was a status enhancer. In some cases, failure to embrace Christian norms would hurt you. And then there's a change around 1994 is the year he places it. It really doesn't matter exactly what dates. People can argue about that. Just look at the direction, the trajectory here. Then we enter a neutral world in 1994. Christianity is seen as socially neutral attribute. It no longer had dominant status in the society. But to be seen as a religious person was not a knock either. It was more like a personal affectation or a hobby. And Christian moral standards retained their residual force. Then we shift into negative world. He puts the date as 2014. And in this world, being a Christian is now a social negative. It's especially in high status positions. If you're a Christian, that is not going to help you to advance. And Christianity in many ways is seen as undermining the social good, and Christian morality is expressly repudiated. Now, I think there is a persuasive argument that, as I said, whatever dates you put at the transition points, that there's been a major shift from where we were 20 years ago and from where we were even 10 years ago. In 2014, a couple things happened around that time that just show an acceleration here. Major shift in American culture around the year 2014, it was the Ferguson protests, if you remember those. And a number of left of center and center writers have identified 2014 as what they would call the Great Awakening. I'm not using these words with any political sense. This is what center-left writers themselves have used. And a Google search reveals a number of other writers, of a number of writers who say the same thing, basically. There was an academic study that notes, our results show that the frequency of words that denote specific prejudice types related to ethnicity, gender, sexual, and religious orientation has markedly increased within the 2010-2019 decade across most news media outlets. And this started around 2015, and it's just accelerated. Zach Goldberg did a LexisNexis search of newspapers for appearance of a variety of terms related to the woke turn, and they tend to show a very stark acceleration in this same time period. So something fundamental changed, especially in the discourse on race, around 2014, and this has had a major influence on key institutions of our society. Generation Z, Americans born after 1996. I'm going to tell you the relevance of this just a minute. 51% of Generation Z report that America is inextricably linked to white supremacy. Now, why is this important? I don't want to get into CRT and this and race issues at all, but many people who are involved in these movements will say that, will link it to Christianity. They'll say that patriarchy, white supremacy, institutional racism that has spread throughout all of our, every institution in our country is what they would hold. This is a product, it came from white Christians. And so if you spend time in those movements and read what they're saying, you'll see that there is a bias against Christianity. So this really started to heat up around 2014. Also, there was a major change in views toward homosexuality in this period, in the Obergefell decision that legalized gay marriage in 2015, and a new regime, legal regime, started to be born out of this, and we're still seeing how it's being elaborated. And maybe that decision was more an effect than a cause. It was following the culture. But clearly there's been a major and very rapid shift in sentiment during this time period. In 2008, you may remember that a majority of voters in California, approved Proposition 8, a constitutional amendment to ban gay marriage. This was in 2008 in California. Can you imagine that? In 2008, Barack Obama campaigned for president as an opponent of gay marriage. And he specifically cited his Christian faith as a rationale for this. He had, in fact, he was on record as supporting gay marriage when he was in the legislature in Illinois, but he kind of set that aside. And it's notable that he felt compelled to present a different position on this issue and even stress his Christian bona fides to be elected. This was in 2008. 8 years later, in 2016, Donald Trump is holding up pride flags at rallies while he's running for president as a Republican. 8 years. Something dramatic has happened. And today, we think just trying to keep men from competing in women's sports as women, it's like a rear guard action trying to claw this back. Just think of how quickly this has advanced. So the average person in America can sense that something has changed profoundly in the last 10 years. And they may not be sure what it is. They may not be able to describe it. They may not know what to do about it, but they know that something is wrong, that something has changed. In 1993, a congressman named Chuck Schumer, you may know him now as Senator Schumer, he introduced in the Congress the Religious Freedom Restoration Act. And then in the Senate, Ted Kennedy introduced the same thing. In the House, it passed unanimously. Unanimous Democrat and Republican support. In the Senate, three senators voted against it. And then it was signed into law by President Bill Clinton. Do you think this law would pass today? It wouldn't, because now, even when it's introduced in state legislatures, there's a tremendous battle opposing preserving religious freedom, protecting religious freedom. So it seems clear to me that religious freedom increasingly is seen as an issue of the political right. And this is a big problem. Political scientist Ryan Burge, he concluded that in 2020, a white liberal is 10 times more likely to be an atheist or agnostic than a white conservative. A white liberal is 10 times more likely to be an atheist or agnostic than a white conservative. So my friend Rod Rehrer, I read his stuff a lot, but he says this is terrible politically because for the first time in U.S. history, you're going to have religion becoming identified, very closely identified, with one political party. And this is very bad for the future of religious liberty. The left will likely come to see religious liberty not as a fundamental American value that's guaranteed by the Constitution, but as something conservatives use. This is what Rod Dreher says. The conservatives use to exercise bigotry and privilege over liberals. That's how they will come to see it. So you will see a politicization of religious freedom. As I mentioned, wherever religious freedom is intersecting or clashing with LGBT right now, who's winning? It's because of that, the hierarchy of human rights and religious freedom being seen as more as something that belongs just to conservatives. Now you look at law schools, at judges, at courts. Again, I'm relying on Rod Dreher for this. He says, years ago, the pseudonymous Ivy League law professor Kingsfield, he's pseudonymous because he couldn't give his name because it would expose him to being fired, but he's a law professor at an Ivy League school, said that virtually nobody in elite law circles is a religious believer and therefore lacks a natural understanding inherent to believers of why religion is important. And Kingsfield said that the institutions that produce our federal judges are functionally atheistic. And this is going to have a profound impact on religious liberty jurisprudence down the road. We have robust protections now. How well do you think people coming out of these institutions who not only disagree with you, but also cannot even begin to understand why religion is important to you, can you trust them to protect your freedoms in the future? And the last point in this, what we're dealing with now, is truth. There is tremendous disagreement in our society about basic concepts of truth. What is a family? What is a woman? What is a man? What is justice? What is marriage? And they're very different views on this. Has anybody here watched the documentary, What is a Woman? I recommend that you watch that. Very important. It will really give you a picture of what we're living in. Very few people apparently are willing to say what a woman is or even know what a woman is. And the documentarian said, he was asked, why is transgenderism so important for the left? He said, this is really an assault on truth itself. This is relativism. That's the ultimate goal here. They want to kind of rid society of any notion of a shared reality or shared truth. The problem is that we claim to know truth. So this is, I think, the situation, the context we're in now. I know this can be very dry, but I'm trying to build a case that will alarm you. That's why I wore a pink shirt. My wife said, Andrew, it's good that you're wearing a pink shirt because it'll be a little disarming. It'll be more of a happy color. So now I want to look a bit at the future. Have you heard of moralistic therapeutic deism? It's a big word, but it's actually kind of simple. Christian Smith and his fellow researchers at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, they took a close look at the religious beliefs held by American teenagers. And they found that the faith held and described by most adolescents came down to something they identified as moralistic therapeutic deism. And this is how they describe moralistic therapeutic deism. These are the basic beliefs. A God exists who created and ordered the world and watches over human life. So God exists. God wants people to be good, nice, and fair to each other, just like is taught in the Bible and by most other world religions. The central goal of life is to be happy and to feel good about oneself. God doesn't really need to be involved in your life very much, except when there's need for you to resolve a problem. And good people go to heaven when they die. So this, in sum, is the creed to which most adolescent faith can be reduced. God wants me to be nice. He really, really wants me to be happy. And if I'm good, I go to heaven. So this was 2005. This was the millennial generation. This is our next generation of leaders. How can this, and this was in the church. So how can this level of faith survive the dark wave that is coming? God wants me to be nice, he wants me to be happy, and if I'm good, I'll go to heaven. If this is your basic worldview and your basic theology, will you stand and pay a price to follow Jesus? Here's a result of this kind of moralistic therapeutic deism. Only 45% of weekly churchgoers, believe that parents who have children together should be married. 45% think that two people who have children together should get married. According to Pew Research, over half of white evangelicals under 50 support gay marriage. I'm dismayed when I read well-known evangelicals who say, I hold to my traditional views on marriage and on sexuality, but I do realize that there are many different ways to interpret Scripture. Now, let's move on to Gen Z. 51% of Gen Z believes that the gender binary is outdated. 59% support expanding non-binary gender options. I read a report recently that among those under 30 years of age, a wide range of surveys converge on a number of around 20% who identify as LGBT. The interesting thing is many of them aren't practicing it, but they so identify with the ideology that that's how they identify themselves as LGBT. So that's 20% of Gen Z. 41% support censorship of hate speech. Hate speech. 66% support shouting down speakers they consider offensive. 23% support using violence to silence such speakers. Who do you think they're going to want to silence? You. Faithful followers of Jesus. Because if we follow the commands of Jesus, if we hold his standards, people are going to say this is not loving, this is hateful, it's not inclusive, this is a religion of hate. We know it's not true, but that's what people will say. So this is our future. This is the next generations who are rising now. Now I want to draw briefly a broader context to discern the times within which this is taking place. And I think there's an acceleration going on now. I want to read a paragraph from a writer who will say it much better than I will, a man named Paul Kingsworth. He's sitting around with a friend and during this COVID times, this is what he says. Something big we both agreed had shifted, but neither of us could quite pin it down. On the surface, of course, we could point to the obvious changes, the unprecedented biosecurity state which governments had imposed in response to COVID, the accompanying media censorship operation, the vaccine passports, the normalization of mass surveillance, the digital attempts to enforce uniformity of opinion on key issues, deepening political divisions, crumbling public trust in institutions, supply chain collapses, coming food shortages, European war. These are the symptoms of the times, but there was a shared sense that something else was going on behind them. We both seemed to feel as though something huge was moving beneath a deep ocean, and we could only see the ripples on the surface. Whatever was happening, it somehow didn't feel rational or even really explicable. It felt like some psychic force was at work, as if some eruption from the underworld was playing out around us. So with all the things I want to mention now, there are spiritual forces behind them. And as I mentioned them, think Satan hates God's children. He wants to destroy the church, and he will use these different systems, especially against the church. So I already mentioned COVID here and the way that government has become much more restrictive, you could say. Another trend I see is the weaponization of the Western financial system against Russia. So of course, Russia has invaded Ukraine. It's a terrible thing. But the way that the West responded was using a system called SWIFT, which is how all financial transactions take place between banks. And the Russians were abruptly cut off from the SWIFT system. It means all of their banks became isolated. They couldn't transfer money anywhere. Corporations and businesses were willing to lose money. They lost money leaving Russia, but they were willing to give up on profits to assert their moral stance. And you may agree with their moral stance, but be aware that their moral stance is going to be very different from yours on a number of subjects. They were willing to give up money and profits to be moral. And they went far beyond the sanctions actually require them to do. Credit card companies, many people in Moscow, credit card companies don't work there anymore. People who were on the subway could no longer use their subway cards to get around the subway in Moscow because suddenly all of the credit card systems stopped working because they were cut off. So all of this was done very quickly in unison against people who are now understood to be evil and hateful. I'm not supporting Putin in any of this. Please don't think that at all. I'm showing what happened, how people were, the financial system was mobilized. And all that is being applied to the Russians now, who are suddenly a hated people, can very quickly be applied and will be to faithful followers of Jesus. There are a lot of Russians who were on vacation who suddenly were stranded with no money because their bank cards didn't work any longer. So the financial system, the weaponization of it in the last few months is going to have profound repercussions. You're going to see some of those in the years ahead. One of those, let me move on to this, is that we're headed towards digital currencies. I'm not a conspiracy person. The Biden administration and the EU have both very publicly described digital currencies as an urgent priority, and I'm not talking about cryptocurrencies, those are very different. These are central bank digital currencies, they're government operated. And it just so happens that if it's all electronic, if they're digital, and the Chinese are preparing one as well, by the way, we have a friend who is working with governments around the world at a very high level, trying them to get them to adopt a digital system that will provide more privacy protections, trying to get them to do this instead of adopting the Chinese digital currency that's coming. My point is this isn't some fantasy. It's actually being worked on right now and by very high-level people, and it is coming. And it just so happens that these digital currencies would provide governments with completely unprecedented surveillance and control over all transactions, wherever they in the world they occur, in real time. And to make this work, they will need a harmonized digital ID that will be required. Now, we traveled over in Europe a bit during the COVID times. Everywhere in some countries, you had to have a QR code that you were vaccinated to get on transportation, to go into a restaurant, to go in shopping for food. If you didn't have your QR code, you were not going in. Now, these things are coming. And when central bank digital currencies are instituted, a social credit system can be put in place very easily. And it will be far, far more difficult for us to say or do anything that dissents from what the culture and society demands. One other thing, woke capitalism. I'm not a conspiracy person again. I'm going to read from the Wall Street Journal and from people like that. I'll tell you where I'm getting this from. In 2018, the Vanguard founder Jack Bogle sounded an alarm about the risk that a handful of giant institutional investors will one day hold voting control of virtually every large U.S. corporation. He said that the impact of this growing dominance on financial markets, corporate governance, and regulation will be major issues in the coming era. So those of you who have a retirement fund, this is from The Atlantic magazine. Some $11 trillion is now invested in index funds. Probably some of your funds are in index funds. This is the most popular way of investing now. As of 2019, more money is invested in passive funds than in active funds in the United States. Indexing has gone very, very big. For 9 in 10 companies on the S&P 500, their largest single shareholder is one of the big three. That's BlackRock, Vanguard, or State Street. For many, the big indexers control 20% or more of their shares. Index funds now control 20 to 30% of the American equities market, if not more. And there are three companies. Indexing has gone very, very small. Although many financial institutions offer index funds to their clients, the big three control 80 to 90% of the market. The Harvard Law professor John Coates has argued that in the near future, just 12 management professionals, a dozen people, not a dozen management companies, not a dozen management firms, 12 people, individuals, will likely have practical power over the majority of U.S. public companies through these funds. 12 people. This is in the Atlantic magazine. Wall Street Journal. Charlie Munger, the vice chairman of Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's long-term business partner, he said the rise of index funds such as those run by Larry Fink's BlackRock has resulted in an enormous transfer of the power to sway corporate decision making. That shift will change the world. Munger said, and not for the better. We have a new bunch of emperors, and they're the people who vote the shares in the index funds, said this Warren Buffett's partner. Mr. Fink, not for Mr. Fink himself, he's the leader of BlackRock, one of those 12 people who votes all of these funds. He's an advocate of stakeholder capitalism, the idea that companies have societal obligations. Do you know what societal means? Yes. Societal obligations that extend beyond maximizing value for shareholders. This is what he says. Capitalism has the power to shape society and act as a powerful catalyst for change. Rather than push companies to pursue higher returns, they're trying to impose their political agenda on corporate America. If you've heard about ESG, it's what's driving, they're forcing these things on companies. If you own 10 to 20% of a company, you can pretty much tell them what to do, and they'll do it. Now, where we are at present, with the commanding heights of our society, the loss of religious freedom, where we're going in the future with the millennial generation and Gen Z with their views, with their moralistic therapeutic deism. And then when we look at the wider context of more control, digital currencies, a weaponized financial system, and the corporate world, who are all going to be protecting our society from people with evil views who are dangerous to the values of our culture. This is why I made this video series, and I urge you as leaders to make it a priority to prepare the people who are in your care. We're not escaping this with an election. It's too far, it's too broad, it's too big. One of the purposes I think that God had in my imprisonment was, if you know my story at all, you know that I broke. I thought I was really strong, and I wasn't as strong as I thought. And I broke repeatedly and thoroughly. And in that brokenness, amidst the doubts and the questions and the confusion, I had to, and on my own, in many ways, I had to learn to think in a different way and take on different perspectives and disciplines that would strengthen me so that I could stand under that pressure and remain faithful. So in that weakness, well, God rebuilt me and I came out stronger than I went in. And I think one of the purposes God had in that breaking and in that rebuilding process was that I learned some of these things so that I can encourage other brothers and sisters who are also going to be facing pressures. Now, I'm not saying that people will go to prison. I hope that that's not the case. But there is going to be increasing pressure. I hope that as I painted this picture, I know it can be very dry, reading from the Wall Street Journal to you and all these statistics. But I want to paint a picture of what we're really, really facing. That it's not just me getting up and enthusiastically talking about the need to prepare. And no, there's something very big. There's underneath the surface, and it's spiritual. When we talk about that quote I read to you about just this sense that there's something big happening, it is. It's spiritual. Satan wants to destroy the church. And he won't be able to, but he's going to try really hard. And I think many people will be knocked out if we're not prepared. So when we look at digital currencies, or we look at, you know, some of these other restrictions, or what the corporate world does, there are spiritual forces at work that will weaponize these to try to hurt God's people, to silence the voice of the church. And we need to make sure that our people are ready for this. And this is the purpose of the video series. It's not going to accomplish that. Okay? But the purpose is to make us aware and then give us some tools. I think of Brad, actually, he's going to explain more of this later, but God began to prepare him 20 years ago for this, very specifically, and he's going to share that. But since then, he has intentionally been shaping his teaching and discipling in the church to try to prepare his people to stand under pressure. And so I am confident that God is going to give you, as you press into this, as you look to him for guidance, he will give you strategies. And what the video series is offering is just a kind of a jump start, an introduction to some of these things that we need to head toward. But God is going to give you strategies on how to prepare yourself and your people. I want to close with a quote from the philosopher. I want to read from him. The philosopher Ian McGilchrist, he says, "If you had set out to destroy the happiness and stability of a people, it would have been hard to improve on our current formula. Remove yourself as far as possible from the natural world. Repudiate the continuity of your culture. Believe you are wise enough to do whatever you happen to want, and not only get away with it, but have a right to it. And a right to silence those who disagree. Minimize the role played by a common body of belief. Actively attack and dismantle every social structure as a potential source of oppression. And reject the idea of a transcendent set of values." If you wanted to destroy the happiness and stability of a people, that's what you would do. And that's what we are doing. And that's what our children are growing up in. So my assignment is to sound the alarm. To sound the alarm and say the sheep are in danger. The sheep are in danger, and you are the shepherds. And your assignment is to prepare the sheep, to protect them, to shelter them, and to shepherd them. So Lord, give us strategies for this. Show us how to move forward as a church to prepare the sheep in our care, that they may stand faithful even under the wave, that they'll be able to survive that wave. In Jesus' name.
I almost have to force myself to breathe. Andrew, would you come and speak at my grandchild's birthday party? I think that will really just be a... maybe dress with a clown nose and... No, you feel the weight. And that's really the purpose of that, was just for a moment to sober us. Because we hate to be warned. We hate to see what's coming. By our very nature, that can't happen. That'll never occur here. And yet, so many things have changed so fast. I want to be really honest. I don't think the problem is abortion, though it is a problem. I don't think that it's homosexuality. I don't think that it's big media or some change in our currency system. I think the problem is Satan hates everything that God loves. I want you to hear that again. Satan hates everything that God loves. God loves little children. Satan looks to destroy them. God loves the innocent. Satan hates the innocent. God loves the church. Satan wants to destroy the church. God loves marriage. Satan wants to destroy marriage. It's really a spiritual battle. The scriptures are full of a truth that says that when Satan was hurled to earth, he hated the woman and her child, who was called the Savior. And so he pursued the child to destroy it. That's the mechanism. Okay, so this is supposed to be a wake-up call. And I know we can only do so much of this, but I want you to ask yourself, is there a seed of truth that feels right in my soul? Is the Lord speaking? We're going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back and we're going to talk about the pragmatic side. Andrew gave us the Dark Lord, you know. He gave us Voldemort and Darth Vader all rolled together, maybe. And yet it's true. And we're going to come back and talk now about the pragmatics. And we're going to begin our session by showing you the summary video, one of Andrew's videos, so you'll get a sense of what the series is about. So my watch says 3 after. We're going to start right at 3:15. That's not enough time to make 5 phone calls, but it is enough to do a bio break. At 3:15, we will start, and we're going to play one of Andrew's videos, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about how the process might be helpful in your church in a very practical way. We'll see you at 3:15. God bless you.